up, he is the Pulitzer Prize winner whose latest reporting is in the current New Yorker and whose latest book, The Forever War, is now out in paperback. Dexter Filkins. Dexter Filkins. That's what you look like. I've read you for years and always loved everything I read, but I never see you on TV. Some of the reporters do TV. You never did. Why is that?
You'll see.
Oh, yes, we shall see. Just check out the upcoming clips here of Dexter trying to justify the righteousness of one form of violence over another form of violence.
Oh, fuck. Well, I admire that because you take your reporting seriously. And, well, yeah, I mean, you do. And I do, too. And I don't want to... And this might blow your mind, but, you know, as a guy who's been over there for years, knows everything about it, I have to say, and as a guy who's read a lot of what you have written, I don't see that much difference between a guy who's been there forever and just the guy who casually, intuitively goes, yeah, we shouldn't be in Afghanistan.
Well...
I mean, just like
it's
on
hard
this,
to argue with it.
Yeah, I mean, just on the surface. I mean, just a guy who doesn't think about it a lot just goes, you know what? We're in a foreign country where the people are backward. How?
And here's somewhere Bill Maher really fails, I feel, a lot, in that he loves to group entire macro populations and label them as backwards and macro cultures, if you will. He does it a lot with Appalachians. He refers to Appalachians, anyone not from a more East Coast, West Coast elite set, as hillbillies, basically anybody in the middle of the country. And in this case, he's doing the same thing with Afghanistan. He's labeling it as backwards when he's not asking the question, why is Afghanistan backwards? Why is Appalachia backwards? Could it be that there's... It's pretty much the result of a century of economic domination by tiny interests in places outside of Afghanistan. I wonder if that's the cause. It's maybe their culture's effed up because all the countries in the world keep effing them up.
In this work.
That's like the conversation with the taxi driver. Yeah, when I get to New York. yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and it's hard. You know, you have to kind of say, well, there was 9/11. That was 10 years ago. Remember...
But it never really could work, could it? I mean, they are backward. The first chapter of your book is all about how you're in a football stadium or a soccer stadium and they're cutting a guy's head off.
Right.
And you talk to the people and they say, well, you guys have TV, we have this.
You will be executed.
What do you make of...
And they never give us credit for the Muslims we don't kill.
Credit for people you didn't kill? Well, let's give credit to Adolf Hitler for all the Jews who are still around today. He didn't kill them. Good for him. How about that Idi Amin? There's a lot of Ugandans alive today. Still. Good job, Idi.
Well,
I know they hate the drone attacks, but haven't the Taliban killed a lot more people than drone attacks?
Well, and the Taliban have killed more civilians than anybody.
Right.
It's true. I mean, when on the pretty rare occasions when an American bomb goes into a village, I mean, it's still relatively rare, kills a lot of civilians. The U.S. makes a lot of efforts to kind of make amends. They apologize.
Ma'am, we are very sorry for the bomb that we dropped on your village that decapitated your entire family. I see your husband over there. He has all his entrails sticking out his belly, and you're the only surviving member, so we'd like to give you a lifetime membership to free meals at the McDonald's in Kabul, and I'm sure that this makes up a lot for your sorrow. You know, that's just part of the way things got to be done, and... the fact that you'll live a life of wretched sorrow and probably post-traumatic stress disorder until you die is just part of this existence here on planet Earth. Thank you, ma'am. This is Sergeant Goofel Weimer, and I'm out of here.
They try to compensate them.
And they lie.
Sometimes.
You got to give credit to the law.
they're not doing suicide bombings in the middle of Kabul that kill, you know, 75 civilians.
Can't you see the bombs that we drop on people are a lot nicer than the bombs that they drop? Why, look at these fellas right here gathering on the street corner. Look how nice we were to them. We didn't shoot the whole town up. We just shot all of them. Of course, we found out later they really wasn't doing nothing, and a couple of them were journalists for Reuters. But hey, we didn't shoot the whole town up, did we? And that's some nice righteous violence. And just look how civilized we are right here. Why, while these people are trying to help some of the wounded off the scene, we're so civilized we didn't shoot the whole town up. We only shot the people trying to get the man to the hospital and his children who were inside the van because he was just a good Samaritan coming by the scene. As you can see, right here it comes. You know, see, we spare the whole town. Oh, there, and we just got them. Of course, we goofed, but hey, shit happens, man. America, fuck yeah.
Arrival. Crest of 20, Commander 89 is active. Port arrival 311. 20.
Well, what about the embassy? They attacked the embassy this week, and for a lot of us of a certain age who remember Vietnam when we were children, very young children, it reminded me of Tet, you know, the Tet Offensive, which freaked Americans out. If there was one thing that turned Americans against the war in Vietnam, it was, oh my gosh, you know, we thought at least the Capitol was safe.
Right.
But here they are in the heart of the Capitol, and it seemed like that was what was going on this week in Kabul.
Yeah, there's some of that. It's not a bad analogy, but it's, I mean, if, you know, Tet was like a huge offensive around the country in Vietnam, and, you know, we killed 30,000 of them when it happened. And this was more like 20 guys got into the city and got to the embassy and attacked the embassy.
Well, we always win the battles.
We always win the battles.
But we never win
the...
We've won wars, but these kind of wars, we just don't win.
It's hard.
But, you know, it's funny. You said we didn't get a victory parade and we didn't win. I think we did. I think the big story that was missed in the 9/11 anniversary that we just had, and by the way, why couldn't the media have done something about it? It seemed to come and go, and I didn't see a thing except the Clydesdales praying at Ground Zero. Because if you can't use that to sell beer, what can you? But, you know, there was this big, I know New York was on high alert. There was a big warning that, you know, they're going to do something on the anniversary. It's specific and it's credible. I didn't think for one second it was going to happen, because I think between the NSA listening on every call, the Patriot Act, for good or bad, and between the drone attacks, you know, these guys, they are defeated. Not that we shouldn't be vigilant, of course. They could always come back. But it seems to me like, I mean, their biggest threat this week was, we're going to blow up a truck.
Right. No.
You know, I mean, we forget that we were fighting these 7th century people to begin with. Their best weapon to start with box cutters. Their best weapon was our unpreparedness.
Once again, Bill just doesn't get it. Their greatest weapon was their knowledge that our country operates a vast global military-industrial empire. And that very same military-industrial empire, when attacked directly at its heart of commerce, would completely overreact, freak out, and spend its very own country into economic oblivion. Looks like that happened.
More prepared. We're, of course, vengeful motherfuckers. We've taken out their leader. I mean, Zawahiri, who is their leader right now, I guess, they say he's on the run. They say he has to sleep in a different place every night, which is kind of poetic justice for Salman Rushdie.
Right. Indeed, yeah.
Haven't we...
I really like how Maher reduces everyone to, in every conflict, to almost like a comic book characterization of, you know, good guys and bad guys, cowboys and Indians. And completely glosses over the thousands of people who didn't make it into the cowboy and Indian celebrity comic book world and died and left their families with sorrow. 6,000 some, I believe, on the U.S. side. Countless thousands in the Middle East and across Afghanistan. And it all just seems to be... good guys, bad guys, cowboys, and Indians to him still.
As much as you can win a war like this, haven't we won?
I think yes and no.
Yes and no is not and answer. Bring the troops home now. Peace.